I wish I had time to talk to each one of you and ask you how many of you said this past week, I am doing a great work and cannot come down after last Sunday. I hope that that sticks in your mind and you are using that. People are watching your life and mine. They are looking for something authentic, something that works. And when they see it, they will eventually ask about it. Andy Stanley writes and tells of a personal experience of his own. He says, I have a good friend named Pete. Pete has been a Christian for 2 years at the time he writes this. Pete is from the former Soviet Union. He's never heard the name of Jesus Christ until he was 10 years old. His family moved to the United States when he was 12. His parents were agnostic. That means they didn't believe that you could know there's a God or not. Therefore, he had never been encouraged to explore anything that had to do with religion at all. When I, Andy says, met Pete, he was not a Christian, but he was full of questions about Christianity. I told him I'd be happy to answer as many questions as I could. We began having lunch together every week or every other week or so. That went on for 10 months. During our first meeting together, I asked Pete why he was so interested in the gospel, in Christianity. And this is what he said. I am in business with several families who have the kind of marriage I want to have someday. All of them are Christians. I know their families are the way they are because of their Christianity. After 10 months of Bible study and debate, Peter prayed to receive Christ. Why? Because several couples conducted their marriages and business in a manner that was different from the norm. And upon close examination, Pete caught a glimpse of something divine. Their lives birthed a vision in Pete of what could be true of his own marriage someday. They lived lives worth watching. And unbeknownst to them, Pete was watching. What is God accomplishing through your vision? God has something he wants to accomplish, not only with the vision that he's given you in your life, but also behind that vision, something that he is doing that you and I might not even be aware of, really. And so today, as we look at Nehemiah 6, verses 15 and 16, we want to really emphasize the fact that God wants to bring other people to himself through your vision. Whatever it is, God wants to bring other people to himself through what he's doing in your life. Now, if you turn with me to Nehemiah 6, 15 through 16, we're just going to look at those two verses. It's sort of a culmination, in a way, of what we've been leading up to studying during this series of previous chapters in Nehemiah. Verse 15 says, so the wall was finished on the 25th day of Elul in 52 days. And it happened when all our enemies heard of it, and all the nations around us saw these things, that they were very disheartened in their own eyes, for they perceived that this work was done by our God. The walls were rebuilt in, what did you say? 52 days? Walls around a city? Let's think of the chronology of what we've studied already, okay? Very quickly. Nehemiah first heard of this problem. Remember back in the king's court, as his brother came back to report to him about the city of Jerusalem, and he was greatly grieved and challenged. That was about November, December. You say, well, why 2 months? Well, because the Jewish month that it gives, you know, is over parts of our 2 months, all right? So that's why we put November and December. So end of November, beginning of December, that time frame. Then secondly, around March, April, Nehemiah, 4 months later, had the opportunity to present his plan to the king. Let me go. do something about this and help me. And of course, we studied that as Nehemiah prayed fervently for those 4 months for that opportunity, took the opportunity when it came, and God moved the king's heart to change his previous rule, say, okay, go ahead. Then it took about 2 or 3 months to make the trip there. Now, let that sink in. It took longer for Nehemiah to make the trip from Susa to Jerusalem than it took to finish the wall. Wow, this is extraordinary. We lost our slide. There we go. Now, the project began in the last few days of July and ended 52 days later in September. 52 days. Now, because of this account, there are some people who question the authenticity. Why? Because it is so extraordinary. I mean, even Josephus, as you read the book today, Josephus was a Jewish historian. And, of course, he's not writing scripture. You know, what he wrote was not inspired by God. He's just recording scripture from his point of view, and he's not always the most conservative point of view. But if you read Josephus today, it doesn't say 52 days. It says, well, over 2 years. Now, we don't know if Josephus really wrote that in the beginning because he didn't believe it was 52 days, or whether that was a later copyist. Many people think that a later copyist copying Josephus' work, because, of course, they didn't have printing presses and all the kinds of things that permanent material to write on, so they kept recopying these things. Maybe a later copyist said, what? 52 days? That's got to be a mistake. No. I mean, it would be very, very conservative to say you could rebuild a wall in 2 months or something like that. So people question, is this really, really true? Well, of course, we know that Scripture is inspired. God has kept His Scripture down accurate, down through the ages. It's the most accurate book we could think about. We don't have time this morning. We've covered it already in adult Bible class. It's the most accurate book attested even by any of our standards today. And God supernaturally has kept it. And if God says it was 52 days, it was 52 days. But why the question? Because it seems so humanly impossible that these people, they didn't have cranes and bulldozers and all that kind of stuff, that they could rebuild this wall in 52 days, especially amidst all the troubles that you and I have read about in the first 6 chapters. And also remember, another thing that's unique about this account, we've mentioned it a couple times, there's no recorded supernatural, miraculous outward events to get this wall built. Okay, it doesn't say that God erected half the wall the first night. You know, it was common people. It was Nehemiah, a leader, coming in. They did all the work. They lifted every stone. They put it in place, all the organization. I mean, they humanly did it, but with God's help. This is a story of a leader and his people following God's vision and with God's help accomplishing something impossible without his help. And that is the point that we want to not miss this morning. God was working on a much greater vision behind the scenes while Nehemiah and his people, the Jewish people, the tribe of Judah, living in that region around Jerusalem, while they were working on a wall, God had something much bigger in view. Let's think back through the Old Testament of the history of the nation of Israel since God chose Abraham. God's ultimate intention was always to establish the nation of Israel as a light to the surrounding nations. He wanted them to be that tangible beacon, that tangible lighthouse, we might say today, that tangible demonstration, that tangible illustration of what it is to serve the living God who created heaven and earth. And that's what he wanted. God wanted pagan nations to see God's activity in the life of the nation of Israel and conclude, wow, the God that Israel serves is the true God. And that was proven over and over and over again. Israel was to serve as a constant reminder of God's greatness and God's power. Now think with me of just a couple illustrations. We don't have time. We could have a lot more of them. The plagues of Egypt. Well, first of all, let's look at this verse, Isaiah 49, 6b. I will also give you as a light to the Gentiles, talking to the nation of Israel, that you should be my salvation to the ends of the earth. That was God's stated intention, that they were to be a light to the Gentiles. The 10 plagues of Egypt. Now, I remember when I was gone here, Ken Pierce came back, and I got to listen by recording to what he said, and he talked a little bit about this. 10 plagues of Egypt. God, what was the point? God, an all-knowing God, sovereign, being able to prophesy, as we're studying currently in the adult Bible class, knowing everything, God knew what it was going to take to finally change the heart of Pharaoh and let his people go and leave the land of Egypt. Why didn't he just go to number 10 at the beginning? What was the point of going through all of these other 9 plagues? Because God was saying something during these 9 plagues. And Ken reminded us that every single one of these plagues attacked something the Egyptians worshipped. Whether it was the sun and God can darken it, the Nile River, which gave them the water they needed for crops and he could turn it into blood, the cattle, on down the list. These were all things that the Egyptians worshipped in their pantheon of gods that they worshipped. And the God of Israel defeated every one of them systematically. So that coming down to the end with finally the death of the firstborn, which again was very, very important in their culture, they would say, you know what? Israel's God is God. I mean, that is God's point. He wants the peoples of the world, of the earth, to know that he is God. And that's what he was doing with those plagues. There's other supernatural interventions, of course, that God did. We think of the Red Sea crossing. Well, now, why did, you've maybe heard the statement, well, God is not a very good general to allow his people in nation of Israel to be trapped between the sea and the Egyptian army. I mean, he didn't plan very well. Oh, yes, he did. He planned that perfectly. That's the way he wanted it. Number one, he wanted to teach them to trust him. Number one, he wanted to supernaturally open up the Red Sea so that they alone could pass through and then cover up their enemies. Because again, for 40 years, other nations heard that story and said, wow, be careful how you treat the nation of Israel, because look at what their God does for them. He is God. Well, 40 years later, the spies go into Jericho, and that's what they hear. The people of Jericho are fearful. They have heard about the Red Sea. They've heard about what your God has done in battle for you, and they are fearful. Well, God again does something strange, doesn't he? He has the nation of Israel walk around this city, and they're playing, blowing their trumpets all of that. Last day, 7 days. They are dedicating this city by walking around it to God, to be sacrificed to him. And guess what? The city knew it. They understood that symbolism of that day. And then God miraculously has those walls fall down. Today, archaeologists tell us that the walls fell outward, not inward. God did it. Again, God wanted to signal to every nation in that Canaan area, I am the God, and I am the only God who can do miraculously all of these things. And he wanted the nation of Israel to constantly symbolize him and present him to the nation. Now, of course, Israel wasn't always the beacon, lighthouse they needed to be, were they? They became idolatrous rather than be the light to the pagan nations. They adopted some of the pagan idolatrous worship. And God would discipline them, usually with an enemy nation. Sometimes it got all the way to captivity. That's why Nehemiah and his people were coming out of captivity. And God was saying to them, nation of Israel, people are watching. I can't allow you to get by with this kind of disobedience because My reputation is at stake. This isn't just about you, it is about me. And that's why he dealt with them the way he did. Now, let's come up to Nehemiah's story. God had succeeded in having this wall built by these people. In 52 days, he had succeeded in showing his power through Nehemiah's vision. In the story of Nehemiah, while Nehemiah is busy with his people rebuilding the walls, God is once again setting the stage to demonstrate his power to the nations. Now, some of that Nehemiah, you know, some concept he understood. The importance of building the wall was not to protect those people, you know, living right there alone. It was because it was a reproach to Israel's God. And he knew that God was not finished with the nation. In fact, God had promised to bring the Messiah through that nation. And so he needed to help set the stage for God's program to continue. I refer back to our verses now. Verse 15, so the wall was finished on the 25th day of Elul in 52 days. And it happened when all our enemies heard of it. Now, we've heard about the enemy, Sanballat and Geshem and Tobiah and the people around the surrounding nations. When they all heard of it and all the nations around us saw these things, that they were very disheartened in their own eyes. They were disheartened. Now, that concept of frightened, of awed, think back now. This concept has appeared in this book before, but always the enemies were trying to frighten Nehemiah. They were trying to dishearten the people so they would stop the work. They tried by threatening them with violence, attack, you know, murder at night, all of these kinds of things. They were trying to frighten the people. But now, the people have stuck with it. They trusted God and God's strength, and they finished the wall. And now the enemies of Israel are disheartened, is the word. Really, the word means they lost their confidence. Literally, it means they fell much in their own eyes. Oh, their view of themselves and how powerful and important that they were. And we would say impregnable, you know, they felt that they were strong enough that nothing could happen to them. That got affected. They were disheartened. Their power and their abilities and their place compared to now the God of Israel had totally changed their view. And that is what God wanted. Oh, they had been cocky before. They had accused these builders they couldn't build anything. Remember, Tobiah says, even if a fox jumped up on the wall they're building, the fox could knock it down. All of these threats and these accusations, and now they are disheartened with their plans and what they could do against a God who could help a group of people who were not normally builders rebuild this wall in 52 days amidst all of the trouble that they were trying to give them to stop them. Now they gave the credit. Notice, not to Nehemiah. That's not what verse 16 says. At the end, for they perceived that this work was done by our God. This was too big. This was too fast. This was too great a success for Nehemiah or these Jews from Judah to do. This had the stamp, the imprint, the touch of a divine creator, of the God of Israel. And that's who they gave the credit. The wall had been built in troublesome times, just as God, through the prophet Daniel, had prophesied. Daniel 9:25 says, know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the command to restore and build Jerusalem until the Messiah, the Prince, there shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. We're studying prophecy in the old Bible class, and we studied this a couple Sundays ago. Then it says, the street shall be built again and the wall, even in troublesome times. Yeah, Nehemiah has the recorded for us all the trouble that he had, both when outside the city and even inside the city, among the Jewish people themselves. And yet, he stuck to the job God had given him, and they were able to finish it. Israel's enemies realized now that they were fighting a losing battle, because their battle was not against the people of Judea or Nehemiah. Their battle was against Israel's God. And look what he can do. We can't beat him. That's what God wanted them to see. This was now an embarrassment to the people. Oh, how ironic. The city of Jerusalem with its destroyed walls had been an embarrassment, Nehemiah said, to God. And they would laugh and mock and use the city of Jerusalem as an illustration. Well, look at Israel's God. Wow, that's how he takes care of his people. Now, this project finished in 52 days was an embarrassment to everyone else around. Wow, look what Israel's God really can do. Andy Stanley has written, with God's help, Nehemiah and his crew did in 52 days what some said couldn't be done at all. And that, of course, was the point that God had planned to make all along. Once again, Israel's neighbors were confronted with the power and the presence of Israel's God. What a tremendous story, and what a tremendous illustration. God was interested in his reputation, not to protect it, that someone could threaten it, but he wants people to recognize who he really is. He wanted these Gentile pagan nations to be attracted to him, his power, his authority, that he is God. You know, we went through Daniel months ago, and we saw how even Nebuchadnezzar, most powerful man in the world at that time, finally has to come to the point of saying, yeah, the God of the heavens, he's really, really God. That is what God wants, and that is what God attained through Nehemiah's vision to rebuild this wall. Now, you and I need to learn from this. God's vision, God has a vision that he's doing, he's accomplishing behind the vision that he gives to you. Or we could say in parallel to whatever he gives that vision to you. You know, the Word of God tells us what kind of relationships we ought to have. We've talked about marriage. You need every marriage, every bride and groom coming to the altar and promising and consummating that marriage, they have a vision for the kind of marriage that they want to have and they think they ought to have. And the Bible tells us a lot about marriage and how it ought to be. Family. The Bible has a lot to say as to how we ought to be raising our family. Other relationships we could talk about. The Bible has a lot to say about how God wants us to live and the truth that our culture and world deny, that there's no absolute truth, and how that affects our choices and decisions and ethics at work and in school and all the places we are. All of those things that we have visions that we know we should be living a certain way, God has a parallel or a much greater vision of what he wants to accomplish through those things. And that's why, by the way, you and I, like Nehemiah, I'm sure, said when he breathed up those crisis prayers, God, why are you allowing this to happen? I mean, we have this great job to do, and now we have this extra challenge to deal with. They have to carry a sword with one hand to protect themselves and build with only one hand. And those kinds of things that Nehemiah experienced. You and I do too. We say, God, this health crisis right now in my life, this is not helping my vision. This is not helping me get done what I need to do. Or, you know, this challenge or this setback or, you know, whatever it is, this loss of job or this relationship, this tension in this relationship or whatever it is. And yet God is doing something behind that, and he's going to use all of that. And people are watching. They want to see if our faith in Jesus Christ is authentic. Does it work? Does it help you in the real crises of life? I think God has believers in every kind of situation, be it cancer or, you know, whatever, for people to watch. I mean, if everything went well for us, then of course people would have no illustrations of the power and strength of God and faith in Him to get us through really tough times in this world. But you and I sometimes are those living demonstrations. The Bible's full of those illustrations in the story of people who serve God as well. And we need to recognize, as Nehemiah needed to, that God is doing something behind this story and the details that I am focused on in this life. God wants each of us to be a light for Him. God wants your life to be a beacon, wants your life to be a lighthouse, wants your life to be a living testimony, an illustration, a tangible object lesson for His power and His awesome, perfect glory. In the Old Testament, God placed that responsibility on the nation of Israel. That's how He wanted to use them. We've already seen that. In the New Testament, God transferred that responsibility now to the church and to individual believers. Think with me of Matthew 5, 14 through 16. Jesus is saying, not to the nation of Israel, He's saying to His disciples, "You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor do they light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand. And it gives light to all who are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify you? No. See your great success? No. Glorify your Father in heaven." This is the overarching program of God, that your life and mine, and collectively as a local church and as the church alive in the world today, be a lighthouse for the glory of God. The focus now is on our lifestyles and our personal character. We are to be a reflection of the character of Christ. A reflection. In the night you look up and see the moon, and we enjoy its light, especially if you're walking at night in the African tall weeds and no street lights anywhere, okay? The moon is a reflection of the sun. We realize that it's simply reflecting back the light of the sun. Your life and my life are to be a reflection of the glory of God all the time. To whom? To other believers? No, to all men, to a world that is lost and needs desperately to see who God is and what He's like and what He offers them. We are to conduct ourselves in such a way that causes people to take notice. Now, right there, that ought to clue us in that we ought not to be, as the drive inside us naturally, the default setting is, like everybody else. We don't want to stick out. We don't want to be any different. Yeah, God wants you to be different. God wants you to be so different that people notice that you're different. And if you're not, then of course, you're not allowing God to use you as He wants to use you. We want them to come to the people, lost people, to come to the conclusion that there is something divine about our lives. Not that we're divine, but that we have a relationship with the divine God, the Creator. We are to live inexplicable lives before them. Lives that they cannot explain. They ought to look at you inquisitively. Say, what? Why did he do that? Why did he say that? Why did she respond like that? Why would you forgive that kind of person? Why would you be at peace in this kind of setting? Why wouldn't you do what everybody else does? Why didn't you just tell him off? Whatever the case is. Why? Why are you so different? God wants to use every facet of our lives as a testimony to His power. Now, we have this strange and incorrect propensity to compartmentalize our lives. And yes, I know men are a little better at that than women, probably. But we compartmentalize it and say, well, you know, yeah, there's this spiritual side of my life. And Sunday morning, I'm in church. And a few times during the week when I pray or study God's word or whatever, that's the spiritual life. That's the spiritual time of my life. But when I'm at school or I'm at work or I'm in the neighborhood or wherever I am, you know, I just have to live and make a living and get along with everybody else, and that's the secular. By the way, our society is doing everything possible to enforce that upon you, upon me as believers. Even our laws and our court systems today are saying, you know, you can privately be a believer, but don't bring that into the marketplace. Don't bring that into your business. You cannot make ethical decisions based on the Word of God in your business. We're not going to allow you to do that. God says, oh, that's absolutely what you need to do, because there's no separation. There is nothing in your life that's secular. Every part of your life, every facet, everything people can see, everything that builds into who you are, that is all spiritual. I am using all of it. If I can use building a wall around a city for my glory, I can use every decision and choice you make in your life and what you say and what you think and your motivations. All of that people are watching, and I want to use it all. There's no such thing as secular and spiritual in God's understanding. While you and I are consumed by the details involved in pursuing God's vision for your life, whatever that is, God is up to something you may not be aware of. He's doing something. He's using you in a way. He's having certain people watch you for certain things in ways that we're not even, you know, aware of. And by the way, young people, there are young people who say, well, that's fine. Okay, grandpa and grandma, somebody maybe watches them because they're supposed to be older and wiser. And they are. And people do watch them. But you know what? There's younger children watching you. I don't care what age you are. There are people watching you. And you can be used of God, can reflect His glory by how you live. None of us are exempt from this. Our visions are means to a greater end, to the glory of God and the salvation of men and women. God has positioned you in your culture, wherever you are, the job you're in, the school you're in, the neighborhood you're in, the relationships you're in. God has positioned you, excuse me, He's put you in that place with all of the challenges that are involved in that. You sometimes hear people say, well, wow, the people I work with. I mean, I heard this just last week. The people that I work with, they're not kind or open at all to Christianity. They are an illustration of as worldly as you can get. And I don't know why God has me in this place. Oh, God has you there as a light. God has something He's doing with your life. You be inexplicably different. Give them something to watch. Our visions are means to a greater end. God has positioned you in your culture as a single point of light, a beacon in a world that desperately needs to see something divine, something that is clearly not of this world. He wants to use you to draw people to Himself. That's what He's about. Therefore, it is disastrous for us to compartmentalize and say, well, at work, I nothing I can do there for God. Some of you are tempted to say, well, now I'm not in any kind of religious or spiritual occupation. I'm just a common worker out here trying to earn a living and make the best, wisest business decisions I can make and whatever. Oh, that's very important. You have lots of non-Christian people watching you and how you operate. And God is, He doesn't make any differences between the religious and the secular. And how you and I live and what we say and what motivates us, He can use. We underestimate God's interest in our secular pursuits. Let me quote Andy Stanley again. The truth is, our secular pursuits have more kingdom potential than our religious ones. For it is in the realm of our secular pursuits that secular people are watching. The marketplace, the club, the salon are the environments that so desperately need a brush with the divine. It is there that God desires to demonstrate his power through those who are willing to be used in such a way. It is in the context of those arenas that the awe factor is potentially the greatest. Now, of course, what we do here in church on Sunday morning in exhorting and preparing ourselves and fellowshipping together and so on so that we can go out during the week and be this kind of lighthouse, it's important. But, you know, the lost people generally don't come in here to observe us. They're watching how you and I live out there. That's where we have the biggest opportunity to create an awe. Why does that person operate like that? We need to see ourselves as lights at all times, in all contexts. We need to see that every role, every relationship, every responsibility carries divine potential. So I ask you this morning, whatever your vision, whatever your focus, whatever is important in your life, how can your vision, how can what you're pursuing, how can what you want in your life and desire, what you're working for, how can that glorify God? And I don't know, maybe up until this study through Nehemiah, you've said, I have no idea. I don't think it can. I mean, I'm just doing what I have to do to live. No, God wants to be glorified in every choice you and I make. Ask yourself, what about my vision has the potential to point to the presence and power of God? After all, every single one of us are ministers. We're all to be ministering. Okay, I'm not the only minister here at all. We have sort of given that an occupational meaning. But no, all of us are ministering. We are ministering no matter what we do. Ask yourself, how could God receive glory from what I am trying to do? Now, let's think about just a few characteristics very quickly which can attract attention to God. Number one, peace of God. Philippians promises us that you and I as believers, if we trust God, not worry, God will give us his peace. That is what? Beyond all understanding. Oh, there's something divinely inexplicable. How can you possibly have peace in this kind of situation with what just happened to you, with what that person just said to you? And you're just so calm, and you reacted so calmly. And what is with you? How can you respond that way? Man, I would have given them a piece of my mind or whatever. The peace of God. Nehemiah had a strength. He would pray, tell the people, pray, trust God. He demonstrated that in his own life. Okay, so they're threatening my life. You know, so what? I'm here doing a great work. I'm not going to be disrupted from that or distracted from that. I'm going to trust God. If he kills me, he does. Three men in the fiery furnace. Okay, we cannot worship anything but the true God. And if he allows us to die in the fiery furnace, okay, so be it. That's his choice. A peace that passes all understanding. There ought to be a difference in our lives that we do not worry like the world and be upset and all of those things. That's one of the inexplicable things that they can view and say, something is different about that person. Wow. Another thing is relationships. We've talked about that. Healthy relationships are rare in our world today. In fact, they may be getting rarer with all of the social media and just communicating on the surface electronically. Healthy relationships. How are the key relationships in your life and how do they bring glory to God? Again, Andy Stanley writes, what's this got to do with vision, you ask? Everything. We are not much of a light on a hill if we sacrifice people and purity for the sake of achieving vision. When we do so, we remove any incentive God may have to bless our labor. We become unblessable because we have made ourselves unusable. At that point, there is nothing of significance for God to draw attention to. Wow. You know, if you work so hard 24/7 at your business or whatever you do, and you lose your relationships, you know, your marriage is struggling and your kids don't really have time with you and so on, and you make the big sale or you make the big award or get the promotion or whatever it is, or you get that accomplished, people aren't going to take note. That's just natural, normal. I mean, that's just what the world does. However, if you do your best at work, and God can bless what you do, and you have a wonderful family life, your marriage stays priority, and your relationship with your family and your kids and the people around you, and you don't cut corners and compromise and all of those kinds of things, now that's unique. That's worth watching. That's awesome. That's the kind of person that they say, "What's up with her? Wow." Our relationships are definitely an awe factor, giving glory to God for it takes following His divine direction to maintain and have healthy relationships. A third one, character. You've already alluded to that. For the Christian, character involves doing what's right, as God defines right, regardless of the cost. Notice everything about that is absolute truth. Absolute rightness. We do things for right, not, you know, because some things are wrong and some things are right. Not according to the polls, not according to what's popular, not we can slide by without getting caught, all of those things. When people see character, they assume, they get suspicious. They assume there's a hidden agenda. Well, now, you wouldn't have made that choice just because you believed it's right. There must be something in it to gain that we're not seeing. They're suspicious of it. It goes against the amoral, non-absolutism of our culture and our society. This is precisely why it draws so much attention. This is precisely why it has so much kingdom potential. Why it's awe-inspiring. You see, shortcuts and compromises of our character, that's standard, that's default, that's normal, that comes according to our human nature. The whole world is doing that. That inhibits God from getting His glory, and so those things severely diminish the kingdom potential of our vision. We have seen this morning from these two verses, which sort of culminate the story that we have been looking at in Nehemiah. The wall is built in 52 days. God wanted to bring through this story other people to Himself through Nehemiah's vision of building this wall. It wasn't just about bricks being stacked upon one another in a certain way to protect a few people in the city of Jerusalem. It was about something much bigger. It was about bringing glory to God among all of these enemy nations watching. The walls were built in 52 days because God wanted them built to give Himself the glory. God was working on a much greater vision behind the scenes that the people didn't really know about. God had His own vision behind your vision. And whatever He gives you to do, whether it's biblical or things that He has for you to accomplish, God is trying to use you no matter what age you are. God can use you if we are usable, if we allow ourselves to be that light, if we allow ourselves to be different enough to reflect His glory. What is it about your vision that God can use? I close with story again. Andy Stanley tells about a man. Nick is a CFO of a mid-sized information service business in Atlanta. When Nick got married, he made a decision not to eat with or ride in a car alone with any woman other than his wife. Nick had seen one too many business relationships evolve into something else. He had a vision for his marriage and family. This decision was his way of protecting his dream. As noble as his intents may be, he is finding his decision to be very inconvenient. As the CFO of his company, he is expected to develop relationships with vendors and clients. That means a lot of lunches. Finding a way around lunch meetings with female account representatives is often awkward. As you might imagine, in our world of political correctness, his standard is almost impossible to explain without offending someone. Nevertheless, he continues to hold true to what he believes is the wise thing to do. One of Nick's responsibilities is to nurture and protect his company's relationship with their bank. The account representative assigned to his company was a young, single woman named Allison. Because of the success of Nick's company, Allison was highly motivated to maintain a good relationship with her client. Consequently, she was always inviting Nick to lunch. At first, Nick cordially declined with no explanation, but Allison was persistent. Before long, it became obvious to Allison that Nick was putting her off. This caused some tension in the relationship. Nick decided it would be best to explain to Allison what was up. So he told her about his decision. He assured her it had nothing to do with her, and that he maintained this stance with all his female clients. Instead of being offended, Allison was intrigued. She began asking questions. The conversation quickly transitioned from business to more personal issues. She told Nick that she had never met a man who was that serious about maintaining fidelity in his marriage. In her world, the opposite was generally the case. At one point in the conversation, Nick felt the freedom to share with Allison about his faith in Christ. Again, she was intrigued. Nick went on to share the gospel with Allison. She was visibly moved. Nick asked her if she would like to put her faith in Christ as her Savior, and to his amazement, she said she would. They bowed their heads together, and Allison trusted Christ as her Savior. Nick's vision for his family was the catalyst God used to accomplish his primary agenda, namely drawing attention to himself. When Nick made his decision to limit who he ate with, he was thinking in terms of the vision he had for his family, his marriage. But that decision, along with Nick's refusal to compromise, positioned Nick as a light on a hill. People are watching you. They evaluate everything you do, everything you say. What are they seeing? What are they thinking when they watch you? Is there anything for them to be awed about? Who do they see when they watch you? Do they see just you? Just the normal, natural, human you? Or do they see something divine? Can they attribute all your success to your own hard work and good luck? Or is there something about your life that causes them to stop and wonder? God has a much bigger vision behind what he has you, what he has me involved in. And we need to be the light that he wants to use. Father, thank you for this story and these verses in Nehemiah showing us that all along you have had a much greater vision than Nehemiah or the people, putting block upon block of this wall. You wanted to bring glory to yourself. And have every nation watching and every nation reading this account and every nation aware of this story say, wow, what a powerful God. And they be drawn to you. God, you want each of our lives, no matter what age we are, no matter where, what position in this culture you have us. You want us to be a lighthouse for you. And in order for that to happen, we need to be different. We need to allow your divine power to change us and to change our life and to help us stick with trusting you and having the peace of God, to be able to have the kind of relationships, to be able to have the kind of character that does not cut corners, that is not forced and pressed into the world's mold, but that is different. And may we reflect your power and your greatness and your glory, and may people be drawn to you through us. In Jesus' name, amen.